I've a number of GLers have informed me of the time Wall spent in China as a young guy, as a teacher, including Bill Stein, who I trust implicitly. And he liked
God bless it.
He liked China. He liked I guess he liked it. He said he was so treated so well. Billy's calling him Manchurian candidate. He taught English in Red China. He honeymooned there. And he has said how well he was treated by the Chinese. I'll be damned. I think that's interesting. I figured
he
out
something. Honeymooned in a communist country.
Yep.
Huh.
Yep. You know, one of these days, it might be today, could be it. We have to, let's be done with Walz. He's not running for president. Nobody's voting for Walz or Vance. Right?
Right.
What's your problem?
So I'm asking if I can use the text I received about this very subject yesterday. So that's what I'm doing. Don't yell at me for sending a text message.
What subject?
About Walz. But continue, please.
Oh,
yeah, and we should also, Joe, we should talk about taking Fridays off, too.
Tim Walz said he is so pro-abortion, Nancy Pelosi has had to tell him to calm it down. I don't want to talk about abortion. I'm going to set that aside. But we will do Walz today, but I promise you I'm weaning us off it. Because he ain't running for president. And if they lose, ideally it could be the end of his political career, which I'm rooting for mightily. Now I predict Walz will be appearing, I would think, somewhat regularly at the state fair, wearing his camo hat and pretending to be a normal guy.
You know he will be.
Well then you look at me.
Yeah.
It's your deal.
I have to produce here.
No, you haven't produced anything all year.
I know.
Will you do that?
I'm going to make it my one for sure thing. I'm going to jump down the staff's throat and say, you got to have him on. Yeah.
Matthew.
Yeah.
Stop it.
Stop it.
It's not going to happen.
It's going to happen.
There's no point in even trying.
This is great reverse psychology.
I will say this about the Rook. If it's going to happen, Rook will make it happen.
How many years has he lied to your face?
Well, how many years has he been governor?
Four times to my face, he said he would come on the air.
Yeah.
And then it just, everything went to pot.
Well, wouldn't the GLers, the large GL state fair audience, wouldn't they love a chance to be with him and have me talk to him?
You're going to tell him you completely disagree with him, but you'll do it in a professional way.
Well,
you might be a little harder on him than you were, say, Paul Wellstone or Governor Dayton.
Yeah.
Cerisi doesn't count because he kicked your ass.
It's enemy territory. He will not venture into enemy territory.
Apparently,
yeah, but I have to call them out. I have to call his staff up by saying, you can't just go on with Vanita every Friday.
No, why
afternoon.
Wouldn't you? Why not? Go on with Vanita and NPR.
That's, Brooke, that's been the whole, and I'm not accusing you, that's the whole MO of the Democratic Party. This clown didn't even campaign outside of the Metro because he knew what was going to happen to him.
The new Democratic Party.
Yeah, you're right. The whole MO is to hide. Look at what happened when Walz got questioned yesterday.
Shh, quiet a minute.
He's hot and heavy over here.
If that's the case, why are they pretending that Walz is going to be their savior of America's rural population? He's not, he can't even identify with rural America.
Because the American voter has zero idea who this guy is. But if he's framed in a certain way with his flannel shirt on and his trucker hat,
but
well,
you
the
see
guy
they
that
have a new hat. It's a camo hat. It says Harris Walz.
The guy that's voting in West Virginia has no idea that. Right.
Well, the other day we were talking about Hope Walz, who I called 19 years old, and then we did the math, and we discovered that, well, she was 15 when she was warning protesters during the week of George Floyd, warning them and advising them when the guard might show up. It turns out that today in the Star Tribune, she is listed as being 23 years old, which means she was 19, which makes it a little more legit for me to bring up. She was 19 years old when she was warning her friends, keep throwing firebombs. She didn't say that, but keep throwing firebombs because the guard's not on the way. And we deduce that the only information she was getting had to be from her father.
Right.
Well, it turns out that Hope's now at 23. She graduated last year from Montana State. She's a social worker. That means she's planning a life in the political world. Okay. Last year, amid national concerns over access to in vitro fertilization, the governor shared how he and Gwen went through 7 years of fertility treatments before she got pregnant. So it's not by chance that they named their daughter Hope. Right. Okay. And they have a son, Gus. He's apparently he's at Central High School. All right. So let's go to Gwen for a moment, shall we? I find it fascinating.
Gwen, when she visited Crete and Durham Hall.
Who?
Gwen, the first lady. She is there for a function, which my son was there at the time. She kept calling it Creighton.
Really?
Yes. I think she was a little confused.
Creighton Durham Hall?
Creighton, yes. Yeah.
Creighton is in Omaha, Nebraska.
Exactly. It's not Creighton.
Now, our staff, given its diversity.
Yeah. 100%.
Our staff might find different interpretations for this. Kelsey found this, our offsite correspondent. We have many. Kelsey's a loyal offsite correspondent. According to Breitbart News, actually, it gets better than that. According to Five Eyewitness News, Channel 5, where it first originated, Tim Walz's wife said she wanted to smell the fires of the 2020 riots because it was a touchstone moment. All right.
Okay.
And we learn that...
is it the same way Kenny likes to smell burning tires?
I think it's a different way.
Okay.
Gwen Walz, Tim Walz's wife, said she left her windows open to smell the burning tires during the 2020 Black Lives Matter riots because she felt it was a touchstone moment. An interview clip with Gwen Walz discussing the 2020 riots and her reaction to them resurfaced online Tuesday after Harris announced she would be choosing Walz as her running mate. In the interview, which was aired on KSTP-TV's 5 Eyewitness News, Gwen could be heard talking about the riots and her choice to leave the windows open as long as the city was burned by looters and rioters. I could smell the burning tires. That was a very real thing. And I kept the windows open as long as I could because I felt like this was such a touchstone moment of what was happening. And then we remember, of course, we were swarmed by rioters after the death of George Floyd, leading to many buildings being burned down and businesses looted, with the violence lasting for 3 days. Okay, Walz did not immediately send out the National Guard, but he ultimately did, about $500 million worth of damage. I interpret this to mean that she and her husband are pretty much on the same page, and by a touchstone moment, I believe, I could be wrong, I rarely am.
Rarely.
I could be wrong, but it sounds to me like they were approving of this eruption in America, that it was about time, given what we're starting to know now, going back to apparently some fondness for China. Given what we know, I take it to mean she thought it was a touchstone moment in the country because they were approving of it. Yeah.
But they said that at the time.
Who said what at the time?
Well, most people on the side of the DFL were all for this type of...
Okay, well, anyway, that's my interpretation of this. Does anyone else have a different interpretation?
I may, just for the sake of argument, yes. Sure. Touchstone usually to me just means a moment in history. Or a moment of whatever. So she saw it as a moment in history that she was witnessing. That's how I would take it. And the only problem I have here is everything everybody says has turned into a political comment either way. And it drives me nuts. But that's part of what Kenny was talking about, how everything drives you crazy.
But she's not wrong by saying that this was a turning point.
I agree completely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you have not convinced me. I believe that the Walls family, given the daughter's behavior and Tim's behavior and the way he governed, I believe it was her way of saying that she was approving of this. Now, I'm not suggesting she would approve of the malicious and specific destruction of a building. I'm not suggesting that. What I'm suggesting is she was approving of the movement that resulted in giving voice to so many people who she's probably worried about being marginalized. And here they were erupting and burning the town down, and she probably enjoyed that. Although burning tires to me is one of the worst smells in the world. And seriously, why you would leave your windows open to smell that is beyond my comprehension. Yes.
So you've never been to a burnout competition then, obviously.
I have.
Serious question. Are you getting, are your perceptions coming from reading the transcript or from watching the interview? I think if we aired the interview, we'd get a better concept of her meaning.
Okay.
It's hard for me to make a choice like you are.
Is it
tone of voice, I think, would say a lot.
Is it important enough to try to find that video
clip? I can look it up quick.
Yeah, well, if you want me to make a choice, it is.
Right.
My tendency is to agree with you, but I think John gives a pretty good counter.
Kenny, the interview is on
Channel 5.
Channel 5's okay.
Website. But I presume that was 4 years ago, so I don't envy your task in trying to find it.
It might have resurfaced, though, just based upon what's happened.
It has apparently resurfaced. Okay. In any event, no matter how we take it, is it important? I think it's only important if we take it the way I interpret it. It's not important if she thought... Well, this is quite the history moment.
I have a different point of view because I lived one block south of 38th in the 3rd Precinct, and that smell was the smell of burning garbage.
Right.
It wasn't the smell of tires. I think when she says tires, she doesn't know what burning tires smell like. You and I do, of course. But what I smelled for weeks was burning garbage, a house fire.
I think Chris might have found it.
I would say those first days, you know, when there were riots, I could smell the burning tires. And that was a very real thing. And I kept the windows open for as long as I could because I felt like that was such a touchstone of what was happening.
I ain't changing my mind.
Yeah, I agree with you, Joe. I think... It convinced me that she was reveling in it.
Mm-hmm. Where was she when she had the windows open?
At home.
It'd be tough to think.
At the residence?
You would think it would be tough for her to have smelled it all the way down Summit Avenue.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Oh, no, it was citywide.
Are you kidding me?
No, it was citywide.
Well, I was
it
often.
It would have been Grand Avenue.
I was often much closer than the governor's residence is and wasn't smelling anything.
I remember those commutes to and from the station, and you could not get rid of the smell if you were in the city.
Yeah, Lake Street was smoldering for weeks.
I understand that, but I'm not sure that... Well, now we're really getting arcane. I'm just not sure it reached all the way 2 miles down Summit Avenue. Maybe it did.
The 1100 block of Summit Avenue. Yeah.
Well, you have to believe her, and I'm going to side with you in this instance.
But I'm thinking,
I think you're right.
If that is the case, it would have been from Grand Avenue. Somebody was burning up a shop on Grand Avenue.
Maybe.
What's the reason for debating this? Why bring this up?
I brought it up because I think what we're discovering about our supposedly folksy governor and his supposedly intact nuclear, not supposedly, he has a wonderful family. His family is, I think they're united in their Mysterian view of the United States. That's what I think. And we ain't going to smell it with this wind.
Right.
And I don't think until most recently that we really understood that about him. He is a gung-ho socialist. A gung-ho, and apparently so was his wife, and I don't know about his son, but supposedly I would imagine so is the daughter if she was in fact trying to warn protesters.
The apple don't fall far from the tree is what you're saying.
I guess I am.
Gotcha. I got a text message from a good friend of the show who is connected
Yes.
And said,
is it one we trust?
Oh, yeah.
All right.
As one DFLer told me, quote, when I signed the endorsement letter, it wasn't because I wanted Walls to be vice president. I signed it because I wanted him to leave.
Okay.
That's from a DFLer.
All right.
Ooh.
And he said, I'm going to guess this. He's not alone.
Yeah.
I've heard that from both sides of the aisle.
Yep.
Ooh. Yeah.
Now, I went on the service road of life, and I had an awakening on diversity, equity, and inclusion, the so-called DEI movement. I had an awakening.
Okay.
DEI is what the likes of Harris and Walls can accomplish. They can accomplish that. You can see it. You can say, my education commissioner is female, and we have a 22% workforce of people of color, and 8% of our workforce is LGBTQ, and they can measure that. That's an accomplishment.
Okay.
That's a DEI. They can't measure, and they don't measure, anything that's meaningful. Anything that's hard and meaningful and must be done, they don't do. You know, copper wire keeps getting stolen from street lamps. That's not important because we've met all our DEI quotas. These roads are a mess. That's not important. We've met all our DEI requirements. DEI is something that they've learned from the failed academy. It spills into the electorate because the electorate's been schooled by the failed academy. And that's why the likes of Harris are so easily or are easily admired. She is fulfilling what the failed academicians have so-called learned, that she's keen and aware of equity. Equity is the opposite of meritocracy.
Meritocracy.
I knew you was
meritocracy. You just made one up.
Don't interrupt me, George.
Okay.
I want a country where we still have meritocracy. I want a country where we still have a border. I want a country where your personal determinations will steer your life. The DEI movement removes all of that from the table, which is why many people might find it appealing. I don't have to do anything, man.
Right. The standards got lowered.
The way we're going, I'll get my check, and I don't even have to show up at the broom factory. I'll just get my check, and I can buy bread, and I'll be cool. This is fine. And I don't really care if this country's being overtaken, not overtaken, but I don't care if there's an influx of illegal immigrants. I mean, we got room, you know, blah, blah, blah. So DEI is something they can point to that they've succeeded with. Can they tell me they've succeeded in stopping the out-migration of labor in Minnesota? Can they tell me they've succeeded in keeping taxes down?
Nope.
Can they tell me they've succeeded in school kids achieving and learning to read and excelling? Yes or no?
No.
No. Can they tell me they've succeeded in keeping pace with all the infrastructure needs in the country? For example, close to home, the Rapidan Dam. Can they tell me they've succeeded in that?
Nope.
Well, but what have they succeeded in?
How do you feel?
That's right. That's what they've succeeded in.
Why do they get a free pass?
Because we allow them
to. Because the electorate has been dumbed down so significantly and so dramatically over the years.
And so illegally.
They don't have anybody that questions their successes. Their successes are DEI. Yeah, go ahead.
In the instance of schools and education, it is being tracked. And in this state, anyway, it's proven to be a failure.
Yes.
But they're doing worse with the education, and yet, it's been tracked.
And
there's
yet,
proof.
It still doesn't matter with those people. You know
it doesn't
I mean?
Matter because they're succeeding in DEI.
And then another thing about DEI, there has been in the last 6 months more and more of pushback against DEI, and a lot of companies are learning their lesson, a la Bud Light and now Harley Davidson Tractor Supply. And I believe it might be John Deere, although I might be misspeaking there, where they are dropping their DEI programs. I don't know about Harley, but I do know that Tractor Supply is backing way far away from DEI.
Let me create an axiom. What Walls and Harris believe in can be measured emotionally. They can't measure accomplishments with facts.
Don't we already have this axiom? Hold on. I'm looking it up. So.
What they can measure succeeds emotionally. What they can't measure are things that actually matter.